Welcome, students. Today we will discuss in our continuation of previous lectures where we have discussed about the database management system and informational projects. Let me discuss or give a very short overview of what we have discussed during the previous sessions. During our previous session, we have discussed basics about what is data, then we have discussed what is database, then we have discussed what is the database management system, then we have also discussed about the different information projects which are based on the database, where database database is as a core component or embedded part of these information projects. Then we have discussed different type of users in our previous sessions. Then we have discussed the conceptual design. Basically, we are in the way to completion for the conceptual design, where it will be completed when we have studied the ER diagrams. Basically, here we are in the pathway to complete this topic. So, let me continue this topic what we have stopped during our previous session. In our previous session, we have discussed about the entity types. I have informed that the independent entities, the entities are the different bricks of a building which have the independent existence are entity types basically. And the properties which used to describe these entities are known as the attributes. We have discussed what is how to represent the entities and how to represent these attributes in the ER modeling. We have also discussed what are the attributes, what are the different type of attributes, where we have discussed the stored attributes, we have discussed about the derived attributes, we have discussed about the composite, simple and different type of attributes. I have also given the different examples for different type of attributes. Finally, I want to represent what we have discussed during the previous session, like the entities are used to represent with the help of these rectangular boxes. And the attributes are used to represent with the help of these ellipses. These are the entities. And this is the attribute. So during the last session we have discussed about the entity types and their representation and the different attribute types and their representations. We have also discussed how to represent a simple attribute, how to represent a multi-valued attribute, how to represent a derived attribute. This is derived. This is multi-value. So these are the different ways to represent different attributes. This is a simple attribute. These are different ways. In continuation of these different attributes, we are now going to discuss the different relationships, their cardinalities, their attributes and weak entities, strong entities, like all these things during this session. Now, the question arises, what is the key attributes? As I told you, the entities are defined with the help of attributes. One attributes or set of attributes are used to identify uniquely these entities and these attributes by using which we use to identify uniquely different entities are known as weak attributes. Are known as the key attributes. Then, how we will represent these key attributes in our ER modeling diagrams? To represent this type of attributes, you can use the lines under the label of these attributes like this. If project ID is a key attribute, then you can represent with the help of these underline like this. Let me discuss a clear diagram. If the project ID is a key attribute, then you have to represent with a line under this, like this. This shows we can identify a project from the set of projects with the use of their corresponding ID. This is a unique value. So again, we can write a project of a company project like this. Department project employee. Departments are characterized with the help of department ID, department name, HOD, etc., head of department. Similarly, project can be identified with the help of project ID, project name, manager, etc. Similarly, employees can be characterized with the help of employee ID, employee name, date of joining, department, or you can write also date of birth, age, etc. Let me repeat. Department is an entity type, project is again an entity type, employee is again an entity type. Department is characterized with the help of department ID, with the help of department name, HOD, and many more things can be also there. Project is characterized with the project ID, project name, manager, etc. The employee can be characterized with the employee ID, employee name, date of joining, corresponding date of birth, age, etc. Now, we can classify or we can be more specific with the help of department ID as a key entity, key attribute, sorry. This is project ID is again a key attribute, employee ID is again a key attribute, and employee name can be characterized with the help of first name with the help of first name, comma, middle name, this one is the middle name, and last name. Employee ID, employee name is a combination of first name, middle name, and the last name. So you can rewrite the company project with the help of key attributes, with the help of composite attributes in this way. This is the more refined way to represent the company database which we have studied or discussed in our previous session. If this is the case that a single attribute is not possible to identify the entities uniquely, then we can go with more than one attributes. We can use the combination of one or more attributes as a key attribute. But this is known as composite attributes. But there is a limitation, or there is a property known as minimal property must be there. So question is that, what is the minimal property with this composite attributes? Let me repeat, if you cannot find a single attribute that is a key attribute, that is a key attribute, then we can go with more than a composition of a composition of more than one attributes to elect a key attributes. But there is a property that is known as minimal property, should be maintained there. So what is the minimal property? Let me understand this thing. If this is a entity E is associated with attribute A, attribute B, attribute C, we have find that this is not possible to identify different E's with the help of either A, B or C. Then we will try to make a combination of A, B and C or C to find in order to find a composite key. Like, let me assume that AB is a composite key. Then what is the minimal property? The meaning of minimal property is that in any case it should not be hold that A independently or B independently can behave like a key. If this is possible, then AB is a composite key. But if the case that A is a key, by using A you can uniquely identify different keys, then what is the necessity of this B in this composition? Hence AB cannot be a key because this is not following the property of minimal. Hence this cannot be considered as a composite key. Hence, if you are going with AB as a composite key, then in any case, it is a key. A does not key, B does not key as independently. Take an example, like project is there. This is a scenario where there is a project entity type. It has three attributes: project name, project ID and manager. Let me assume that project name plus project ID is a composite key, like this. You can see, by the use of project ID, you can independently find the different entities of project. This is itself sufficient to identify different entities of project. There is no use of this project name. Hence, this is completely waste. No need to take this project name. The combination of these two is not following. Not following minimal property. Minimal property. Hence, to be a key or to be a composite key, it is a condition that it must follow the minimal property. For an attribute, it is possible that there may be more than one keys. If this is the case, you can take these keys and mention with the help of lines beneath these attributes, with the help of underlines basically, with the help of underlines. This is similar to example that you have a home having two doors, one is in the front and one is at the back side. Both doors can be used to enter into the home, and both the doors have the different locks and the keys correspondingly. Usually you used to enter your home by use of one key, and generally use the front door key. Same thing is here. If you have more than one keys, you can take all these keys, but generally you go with a single key, and this key is known as the default key. Now, what is the domain of an attribute? What is the domain of an attribute? This is the space defined for the values of an attribute. Like, if age is an attribute of an employee and you have defined that age lies between 18 to 65, like this. Then the range from 18 to 65 or the values resides in between the range of 18 to 65 is known as the domain of an attribute. The domain of an attribute. Now the relationship type. What is the relationship type? This defines a relationship between the or among the different entity types. This can be unary, binary, ternary, or n-ary. If relationship is defined between the in the same entity, this is unary. In between the two entities, then this is the binary. In between the among the three, then this is the ternary. And if the n number of entities are given and relationship is there, then this is the n-ary. See an example. Departments are managed by The departments are managed by employees. This is the name of the relationship, and this is the way how to represent the relationship. This is used to represent with the diamond shaped box. Then, this is the way to represent the relationship. Then, what is the degree of this relationship? Degree of relationship. The number of entity types participating in the relationship is known as the degree. Like, for example, here there are two entity types. One is the department and another is the employee. There are two relationships and these are related with the help of managed by relationship. Hence, the degree of this relationship is 2. I am again repeating this thing. The number of participating entity types in the relationship is known as the degree of relationship. For example, here the relationship is managed by, and this makes a relationship between the department entity type and the employee entity type. Hence, in this case, the degree is known as 2. If there are 3 type of different entities and there is a relationship which is used to relate these entities, then 3. If there are n number of entity types are related with some relationship, then the degree is n. Now, what is the constraints on the relationship type? Constraints are the relationship type. Constraints are basically used to limit or restrict the number of participating entities in the relationship. Let us understand with the example, like constraints defines how much employees are going to participate in this relationship and how much departments are going to participate in this relationship. If you discuss these things very briefly, then the conclusion is that there are 2 types of constraints types used in this case. First one is known as cardinality ratio, and another one is known as participation constraints. Let me discuss what is the cardinality ratio and what is the participation constraints. So first one is the cardinality ratio. What is the cardinality ratio? I am representing here the cardinality ratio. For example, this is n and this is 1, and ratio is n is to 1. What does it mean? How we will discuss? This shows, let me understand how we will read this thing basically. Hide this thing. If you want to read, then hide this one and discuss for a single entity, for this entity type. How? Let me understand. Here in this particular case, one employee works for one department. For saying that this is one department, you have to see the numeric point here. How much it has written? It is one. Hence, how you will read it? It again see one employee will work. One employee works for this one, one department. And if you want to see the relationship from this side to this side, do the same thing in the reverse way. Here again, hide this one and discuss for a single department. You will see the single department or one department can have this one, n number of employees. Again see, hide this one and discuss for a single entity of this type, department type. You will see that one department can have n number of employees. This is the way to read or write or notate this type of ratios. This is known as cardinality ratio. It restricts that n employees can participate or the n employees can work in a department. This restricts then that one department can have n employees or one employee can work in a single department. Let us assume a different example. If this is n is to m, then this is m. Then how we will show this thing? This is n to m. Then how we will read in this case? The same fashion which I have told you in the last example. For discussion from this point to this point, hide this one, hide this n, and say for a single entity of this employee. You will see that a single employee can work for m number of departments. A single employee can work for, see here, m number of departments. And if you want to say this thing from this side to this side, you will need to again hide this one, this n, and read for a single department. How? See this. I have written this part m. Now I am saying one department can have n number of employees. This is known as cardinality ratios. If this is 4 is to 3, this one is a 4 and this one is a 3. How you will read this thing? One employee can work in how much departments? In 3 departments. One department can have how much employees? Can have this one? 4 employees. This is way to notate or read these cardinality ratios. This is basically a restriction on the participating entities of a particular entity type. Why I am saying this? Since example, this is restricting that, this one is restricting, this 4 is restricting that 4 employees can work for a single department. And this is restriction. Again, this one is the thing. Second one, what is the participation constraint? Participation constraint. What is the participation constraint? Let us understand with a different example. This is a project entity and this one is a department entity. projects are handled by departments. This is a case in an industry where it has been assumed that if there is a project, then it must be associated with some department. If there is a project, it must be associated with some department. It means if there is some project which is not associated with some department, it means it is not a project. How this helps to understand the participation constraint? Again, here the example, I am saying that if there is a project, then it must be registered with some department. It means if we have a list of projects, all these projects must have some association with some department. It shows 100% association. It shows all projects are 100% participating in this particular relationship. Hence, you will represent this one by the help of these double lines. These double lines. And this is known as total participation. And this one is known as total participation. It means all the projects belongs, all the projects in the industry must be associated with some department. Until unless it is not associated with some department, it is not considered as a project. So, in this way, we have discussed different things in this particular session where we have continued from the previous sessions and we started with the key attributes, composite key attributes, how to represent. We have also studied how to represent these key attributes in the ER diagrams. Then we have discussed the relationship type, their domain of the relationship type. Then we have also discussed the constraints on the relationship type, that is the cardinality ratio and the is the participation constraint. In our coming lecture or in the next lecture, we will discuss something more about the ER diagrams. We will also learn how to draw the ER diagrams for a given problem. So thank you for watching. Thank you.